thank you all so much for coming to this session. This is one of a series of sessions that we organized on behalf of the Council of Independent Colleges. We were in conversation with the folks that organized the conference, and they were eager to see more higher ed leaders at the conference. We were eager to see more programming around higher ed, and so we worked out a good system. So we've been very excited to bring some innovative and interesting program here. And I'm really grateful to my presidential colleagues who have agreed to be part of this one. This is, as we said, a confidential fireside chat. We don't have a fire, so you'll have to imagine, with presidents. And I think what makes this interesting, I hope, to you, is that it is an opportunity to sort of see into the minds of real presidents leading real institutions, making real decisions about the technology they will purchase, about how they will pay for it, about what trends they're going to bite on and what trends they are going to pass on. I didn't hear all of Bill Gates's conversation, but I did hear him say that, you know, one of the biggest risks about investing in technology is that most tech startups fail. And so for real presidents having to make a decision about spending precious resources, resources that have either been given to them by students or in trust by donors and others on behalf of students, making that decision about when and how to make that investment is a significant decision. So we won't just talk about tech. There's a lot that goes on, as you know, in the president's office and home and on planes and in various places presidents travel beyond just decisions about technology, but obviously we're thinking a lot about that. I'm Marjorie Haas. I've been president of the Council of Independent Colleges for about 18 months. And before that, I too was a college president. You can't ask me any confidential questions though this time. I had served two institutions before that, was a provost at another one and a faculty member before that. So this is, independent colleges have been my heart and soul since I first began my career. And I know that's true for some of you and not so true in other cases for our presidents. But it's really a pleasure, and I'm grateful that you came all this way and are willing to share your thoughts. So maybe we'll start if you could just introduce yourselves. I think you can probably do that beautifully. They are deeply accomplished. You can read about their accomplishments in the program. I don't want to spend our precious time rehearsing those. But tell us a little bit about your presidency, how long you've been there, a sentence or two about your institution, and then something at this conference that has really gotten your attention, piqued your interest, that you're going to be mulling over on your way home. We'll just do this one in order. Jeff, do you want to go ahead first?
Oh, sure. Yeah, Jeff Abernathy. I'm 13 years at Alma College, English professor by trade, and as I joke, kind of college president by accident. And our work in these years certainly has been thinking about what the future will look like, recognizing that the traditional market for Alma College, as for so many, especially in the upper Midwest, Northeast, is shrinking. And so how can we, for instance, help adult learners to complete their degrees? That is something we're just now beginning to contemplate. We've added graduate programs and the like. Of that as we are trying to ensure that all of our students graduate with the traditional liberal arts education that Alma has always offered. About the conference, I don't know about you all. I admit I've been a little bit uncomfortable, frankly. As a president of a traditional liberal arts college coming into this conference, it feels kind of like the CEO of Massey Energy walking into a Green Party drum circle or something. I mean, we've got people at this conference describing higher education as an abomination, describing higher education as a dumpster fire, and these are our leaders. Take it easy, people. I'm an English professor. I am harmless and no threat, and occasionally eat red meat even. No, I think my reaction at this conference has been that we don't want to throw all of daycare out with the bathwater. Right. Let us recall that our institutions helped to win the Cold War, that we have fostered and kindled democracy for hundreds of years, that our institutions will help to sustain our democracy and our world for the centuries to come. So I think the death of higher education is overwritten and definitely exaggerated. And we've got an opportunity in our partnership with EdTech to think about the core values of our institutions, what we do, especially at liberal arts colleges. Our sector is better at preparing students from diverse backgrounds than any sector in American higher education. That is something to prize, and it is a reason among many, many others that our institutions, I believe, will thrive in the years ahead in partnership with EdTech while sustaining our core values.
That was very vivid. Was it the drum circle? And that's amazing. Of course you're in the English field. Hi, Suzanne Walsh, president of Bennett College. I'm the 19th president. I became president in 2019, the fall of 2019, and then COVID. And it's my first presidency. Bennett College is an HBCU, a historically black college for women, one of two in the country. And we are 100% of our students receive financial aid. So there is no family that writes a full check to Bennett. And I think that's important to know. And then what struck me from the conference so far is I am currently obsessed with a company that I was looking to see where their card is. I think I left it down there. This Korean company that I went to visit earlier today was a K-12 product, but I am obsessed. They had two products. One was about creating art for homeschoolers. Oh my God, it's so good. So like painting, so the homeschooler's painting on a tablet basically, and then the AI information that you get back is like about their brush strokes and about cooperation. And like there's a ton of really cool data that you can learn just from the students painting on this tablet and doing these art projects. So I was obsessed with that product. Their second product, also for elementary, was called Math Cell. And it's so on the screen, it has a picture inside of it's like an outline of a head. And inside it has little circle mind mapping, literally, of these mathematic concepts. And they use that mind mapping to show students where they have deficiencies and where they need to work. But again, like the way that they were using tech to do that was phenomenal. Like the visualizations, it makes it really easy to learn and to see as a learner where I am and what I need to work on. And again, like the data that you get back from the AI. So I am obsessed. And once I check out the name of it, I will share. But I thought that was really exciting. And I actually said to them, I could take either one of these products and I could literally just bring it into higher ed, especially given our students. And they would love it. I think that they just had a way of making mathematics accessible and interesting and fun. And by the way, if you complete a certain number of tasks, they actually plant a tree in the student's name. So it's also got this give back component that I think is really classic when it comes to liberal arts. Anyway, that was my commercial for a company whose name I need to go back and look up.
Hi, I'm Bryon Grigsby. I'm president of Moravian University. It's also my alma mater. I've been there 10 years. It is the sixth oldest college in the nation and the first to educate women. It was founded by a 16-year-old girl for, at that time, 24 girls. And then the Moravians founded a boys' school 6 months later. So we're in our 280th year. We're older than the United States. Which I remind people of in legislative roles all the time. We are founded by an educator called John Amos Comenius, and he is considered the father of modern education. He believed education should be fun, and it should be embrace technology. And in the 17th century, that meant for him that you could put illustrations in children's books so they could actually see what you were trying to describe in language. I often wonder what he would do with an iPad today. So he was very progressive. Moravian is an Apple Distinguished School. Every student gets a MacBook and an iPad when they walk in. The faculty thought I was nuts when I did that 10 years ago, and then COVID hit, and I was a genius, at least for a day. but it was a day. I take my wins. Yes, yeah. So what I think I've What I found most interesting here today, besides the conversation between K through 12 and higher ed, so there's a fundamental difference between the schools up here and state universities. The fundamental difference is based on the schools up here are founded on the Oxford style of education, which means small classes with an expert by your side working on your skills. The state universities under the Merrill Grant were founded under an idea of a German university. And so those are large lecture halls where there's a sage on the stage and they are dispelling knowledge to the mass audience. The challenge I felt in digital and online is that the German model of education is more easily replicable because we can just videotape someone and spew it out. Today, meeting a couple different vendors and a number of different things, what I was most interested in is the collaborative tools. Even collaborative tools today, I saw watching a video where you can interlay questions, discussions, an assignment in the video that the students can do. That resonates much more with the type of education that we're talking about, the kind of education that's an active doing. And that's where I'm most hopeful for technology to help us both scale and make valuable our form of education, which is much more hands-on, much more working on the students' skills. It's also why it costs so much. And so the other piece I see right now is AI helping us. Another company I saw does a great product where if you are having issues between two students, they could use this app and AI that could do restorative justice, probably on the level one and level two levels, and then you could have your expert in restorative justice handle level three and level four, but it also brings that all back to the person in charge of restorative justice. So those are some of the things I've seen.
Mm-hmm. I think that distinction, I mean, you drew a number of really important distinctions, and I think that sense of where technology can be an aid, where it's a supplement, where it supports the kind of teaching and learning that we know has that life-changing effect on students. And I wonder, Suzanne, maybe you could, are there ways you're using technology now on your campus that supplement that? I mean, certainly, obviously, all of us used Zoom. We all learned how to do that for good or for ill. I was teaching the one semester I was president of Rhodes College when we had to close down for Zoom, and I was teaching, and you know, it dramatically changed what could happen, right? It was a great tool. We were so glad to have it. There are things I learned worked better, and things I learned were really almost impossible to replicate in a virtual classroom. And I just wondered if you could talk about maybe some of your learning either through COVID or in other ways.
Well, I think that, you know, one of the things that you were just talking about in terms of that Oxford model, I hadn't heard that. I love that. That's a really great way to talk about it. So one of the things that we've been thinking about is, and I said this in a panel yesterday, how do we use technology to make the learning moments precious or the in-person moments precious? And I got that from one of my former bosses. And I think that's a critical way to think about technology in the Oxford model, right? Because it is very personalized. We've been talking about personalized forever, but what do we really mean by that? What is it that we're trying to replicate or improve? Because I think that we can use tech to improve. So the ways that we're using technology to improve the overall student experience are very, like, they're not the most exciting from a technological perspective. They're actually quite rudimentary. So one thing is just using a nudging system, a text nudging system to help. The company's called Persistence Plus. And we love it because we can text the students, we can do pulse checks, like, how are you feeling? What's going on? We do reminders of, like, students, you know, who study, you know, 5 days a week or whatever it is, you know, are more likely to be successful. But it can give tips and it can also do inquiry. And then we collect that data and we can get, again, like a sense of how are things on campus. We're one of the smallest colleges in the country and yet a power user of this text app. And so the other thing that's great about that is we've been able to use it where a student will respond, and we've had this happen a few times where a student has had either a parent or a grandparent who may have been their caregiver pass away, and the only reason we know about it is because they've texted the app. And then we can give the human the assignment to go follow up. So I think that that's been really important. And then the other thing that we're trying to do is a little bit of what you were talking about as well, which is to say, what does online or virtual learning look like at Bennett? And it's not going to be that we can just take some piece of technology and just say, okay, it's going to be asynchronous. What our students are looking for is the personalized piece. So we always have to figure out, how do we add engagement? How do we add something that feels personalized? And when we were virtual for a year and a half after COVID, during COVID, a traditional residential place that had no online learning, and I said, we're gonna be virtual all next year. That went over really well, as you can imagine. And Bennett and HBCUs in particular, we talk about having a second curriculum, which is like the quad. It's that whole student experience. So I spent a full year watching a group of students, our incoming freshwomen. And I was like, we're called Bennett Bells. Can you still be a Bennett Bell if you never set foot on campus? You didn't come for an interview or a tour, and now you're going to be a student. And for a year, they were just completely virtual. And we had our own way of doing this. Well, anyway, midway through the year, I found out the students were going to play video games. I was like, oh, we're playing video games? Cool. I want to play too. And so I invited myself. This is important because as presidents, when people organize something for us, then it's like it's a performative act. But I invaded their space, and they let me. I got killed a number of times, but we don't need to talk about that. I'm very confident, but really bad at games. So I say this to say, when I watched their interactions as we were playing, if I didn't know any better, I would have thought those students were they had been roommates before, and that they knew each other. So I say all that to say, I think we can recreate things in a virtual environment, but it's not as simple as we have a lecture, and you're going to show the lecture. It has to be something that it creates that personal connection.
Yeah. And, you know, I think one of the things we learned, many of us learned in COVID, is that you can do some of the things you do in the classroom virtually, but it isn't less expensive, it isn't easier, it isn't cheaper, it isn't less time consuming. To really do it well, you still have to have that personal investment of a real professor engaging with those students. So that was a good learning for us. Jeff, what are your thoughts?
Oh, well, it's fascinating, Suzanne, your experience. Ours, I think, has been similar to many institutions, as we learned so much from COVID about certainly how to flip the classroom in particular. As we've returned, I think many of us, perhaps in the humanities, especially the older folks, are still teaching as we always have. I still have my English classes at my house in front of a fire in a circle talking about books. I'll probably do that through my career. But my younger colleagues are really embracing these new technologies, especially in the sciences and STEM, where the lab really is where we spend our time in person now, and increasingly the kind of rote learning, preparation for the lab, all the things, that is happening in online settings. We're experimenting with that, and some really exciting work is happening there at Alma College, certainly. I guess the second piece for us is, I mentioned earlier, our graduate programs that we have added. Proud of these programs. Our first was actually in the core arts and humanities, a master in fine arts and writing. And we've got an amazing program, the most diverse faculty, I think, in the country and in any MFA program. But what we learned from that program was that low residency programs can be the model for us, and these are all but online programs. But the question is, what kind of online? It's not we're engaging through the computer, right? It's we're having conversations just like we do in my humanities classes, my English classes, just across the internet in a variety of ways. So now, taking that first program, that MFA, each of our subsequent programs likewise is modeled on that low residency approach that emphasizes conversation, engagement, and connects the students and helps them to, as they graduate, graduate with the values that all of our students have.
Let me play devil's advocate for a moment. Because part of what we're hearing at this conference, right, is that, sure, what you do is lovely, it's like writing with a quill pen, it was all very beautiful. But it's impractical. It can't be can't do anything to erase or limit inequities. And so we may wind up with a few boutique institutions like this, but there's really nothing that we can learn for wider application from the kinds of institutions that you lead?
Wow.
They're ready. They're ready.
I think we're, in so many contexts, misguided there. There are great things. First of all, I would push back, and for most of our schools, as we heard, it's not as expensive as people think. People are talk about sticker price, and I know that the average amount of money that a student pays to go to Moravian is $28,000. That it is $20,000 for a kid to go through the Bethlehem area public school district for 1 year. So $10,000 more to have kids 24/7, 7 days a week with a PhD, four faculty members is not out of the ballpark. Mm-hmm. And I think all the other components that happen on a residential college campus totally transform someone's life, whether they're playing sports, whether they're in clubs, whether they're an RA, or they're running an organization and they're a president of that organization, or they're learning to sit at the president's house and have a class there. Those are all the soft skills that will then become that CEO of that corporation in that company. And I think it's short-sighted if we just think, I'm pushing about against our governor right now, that you can just go into the apprentice field and you don't need a college degree. I think what's going to happen is, yes, you will learn to do injector molding on a line, but after you learn to do that for 15 years, you're not going to be ready to rise up to be the mid-level administrators or senior administrators without all the other soft skills that you learn at a college environment. Mm-hmm.
Suzanne, your thoughts?
What do you look like?
Well, yeah. So I get nervous about calling them soft skills because I think they're actually really hard. Yeah. They're like really difficult.
Hardest.
They're the hardest ones. And I think our challenge is describing what we're doing. Like even help, like what do we do? How do we help people? And I think there was a session earlier today where I heard someone say, we're not all describing critical thinking in the same way, as an example, right? So we think we mean one thing in the academy, and then you talk to employers and you're like, oh, is that what you meant? But we need the English instructors to help us define things. And so I think there needs to be a coming together of both like definitions of what are we talking about, a real conversation about competencies as opposed to skills.
Yeah.
Because over time, it's the competencies that really actually are the trajectory, not necessarily the skills. Google, it's probably like a 7-year-old study now, but I thought it was very interesting when Google looked at employees who had risen through the ranks and were in leadership roles. A majority of them had liberal arts backgrounds, not tech backgrounds. So I think the challenge for us in the liberal arts is how do we tell a story that explains, like, your first job may not be, like, it's not gonna be the, you're making $100,000 with your English degree. No, but you know what, over time, actually you're probably going to get there, and the person who started at $100,000, they may be plateauing. So I think there's an important discussion to be had where we define in a different way, how do we talk about our value proposition? And then we have to help our students explain that as well. And then I'm just curious, how many of you consider yourselves to be just like leaders? Do you think of yourself as a leader?
Mm-hmm.
And then keep your hand up. And then how many of you have a liberal arts degree? Whoa, hey! And I'm done.
Mic drop. Mic drop.
Right. I'm just going to leave this. But I think we need those of you who are in those roles to help us explain, like, well, what the heck did it do for you? And to explain it in ways that we can have a conversation with a governor or have a conversation with prospective students, because there's something about this education that's still intangible, but it makes a difference, which is, again, why I come back to the English majors, because like that is what you know how to do. You know how to explain in a vivid way, in a very clear way, you know, different concepts, and so we shouldn't get rid of all the English majors. We do need your help. I wasn't an English major. I just like to read. I like
thank
words.
Thank you, Suzanne, for that. The English major in a bit of trouble nationally, as we've read much in the papers of late. A quick story. 10 years ago, was visiting with a board member, some venture capital firm that was investing in his company and looking to invest in higher ed. It was a fascinating day, learning all about many of the things that are happening here and we're talking about here. And I'm, of course, sympathetic to EdTech and to to this particular company. And at the end of a long day, talking about all these opportunities, I asked the question, so what's the one piece of advice you'd give to me as the president of a liberal arts college? And she was not shy at all, the woman who spoke up, and she said, stop investing in capital. Don't build anything. Don't, right? That's the view I think too many in EdTech have of what we do. You're dying. You're on the way out. Look, we sustain community and we sustain democracy. The loss of our sector in particular would be enormous to our country. That cannot happen. That will not happen. Will some of us close? Of course. Will we merge? Will we be different? All of us will be different. But the price would be too great for our society, our small communities, that our colleges support, and our nation's democracy at the same time. So we will find a way to sustain ourselves and to thrive, I'm certain, through much change. That reform is needed, certainly for all of us. Likewise, we are needed for America.
Mm-hmm. In a minute, I'm going to ask if there are questions from the audience. But maybe while people think of their questions, I just want to ask each of you, you've talked about some of these intangibles that are not just skills. They may not even quite be captured by competencies. There's a certain piece about education being countercultural in a way, right? Being disruptive to the point that, people in power and elites are often petrified. It's no surprise that the very first thing any dictatorship does is shut down the colleges, lock up the professor, right? There is something dangerous to the status quo about higher education, as much as there is also something about sustainable for the status quo. And so part of what we're always doing as leaders of our institutions is walking that balance, right? We want to encourage students to be critical thinkers in a wide range of, to understand the nuances and the best of, as well as where change needs to happen. I think one thing that surprised me about this conference is that as much as we're hearing about disruption, as much as we've been told that, somebody said we'll all burn to the ground, and the confidence that somehow out of those ashes something that's fairer and more just and more democratic will rise. And I guess I just wonder, whether the state of sort of democratic citizenship on your campus. We read a lot in the paper about sort of the extremes on campus. We all certainly know that increasingly governments are intruding on in public institutions and particularly into curriculum, again, because they find what we do very dangerous and disarming. But we also hear about the sort of self-censorship on campuses. What does that look like? And I think some of you talked a little bit about ways maybe the technology, I heard about an app that could allow students who differ to gather in a kind of safe, brave space virtually to talk through their differences in a meaningful way. And so I wonder, whether democracy, whether democratic citizenship, and what are your thoughts about that? What are you seeing sort of on campus and what are you focused on there? Jeff, do you want to go first? You looked ready.
I think we're all ready because this is the work of liberal arts colleges, right? Since Greek times, liberal arts colleges have prepared citizens. This is what we do, and it's a critical time for our nation, as we know. We are obligated to engage students from across the political lines to model the kind of discourse that is not happening at our country nationally. So at Alma College, we've got a presidential speaker series that welcomes folks from left, right, and center. We are a marketplace of ideas, and we embrace that. I think it's critically important for all of us as leaders at our college and across the country to talk about that marketplace of ideas. We want to challenge our students. If they come in from the left, we want to challenge them with views from the right and vice versa. It's so critically important, and we need to get them together in small groups and help them to think about solutions for our local community and for our country. We're finding that donors are very, very interested in that work in particular, and we've got a major ask that my team here in the room is working on right now to a donor to initiate that kind kind of hard work of getting students who don't agree with one another to work together for local solutions and national ones as well. So I do think that is, you know, this is the essence in many, many ways of a liberal arts college. It's the work that is essential that we do for our nation at this fragile time.
So this is an interesting question. There's a North Carolina Independent Colleges and Universities. That's our association in the state. We each probably have one in our states. And we had a really interesting conversation recently where a professor from Duke challenged the presidents and said, when do you decide to speak up or speak out on an issue? And we wrestled with that for a long time. Because if you speak out or up about one issue, then you're kind of expected to talk about them all. And so one of the things that I talked about in response to that is after the murder of George Floyd, you know, I was being asked constantly, like my students were mad, our alums were mad, because I didn't say anything. Like day one, everybody had their Twitter, like, we stand with you, whatever people were saying that day. And I didn't say anything. And they were furious with me. And so, like, I was getting, and then faculty and staff, like, they were, but the reason I didn't say anything was I didn't have anything original to say. I was mad, I was upset, but I didn't have anything to say. And so I'm going to drop a name, I'll pick it back up. So I had a call. There were three HBCU presidents. I was one of them, the only female, on a call with then candidate Joe Biden. And he said, I just want to hear what's on your minds. And so I took that literally, and I was like, well, here's what's on my mind. Like, what do I tell my students who are black women about what's going on? And I just riffed on that. And then I realized after my other colleagues were like, I think we should double pal. I was like, oh, shoot. I was supposed to be talking about policy issues. Like, I'm nailing this job.
Yeah.
I'm so good at it, and a lot of people don't appreciate how good I am at this job. Oh my God. I mean, they were like on message for like all the things. I was like, oh shoot. So then at the very end, he said, I'm gonna come, so my other colleagues, and then he comes back, he said, actually, Madam President, I'm gonna come back to what you said. And which was super interesting because he had actually been meeting with black women around the country. And this was like no one was there. This was just a very intimate conversation we all had. That led me to another conversation where I said, well, I just said this to Joe Biden. Like, what should I tell my students who are black women? And there's a poem. There's a poem about what should I tell my children who are black? And so what I ended up doing was I took this poem and I used it as inspiration, and I wrote a poem in response to the George Floyd murder, and I called it, What Shall I Tell My Students Who Are Black Women? And it really was about what I wrestled with as a president. I didn't come out with a statement. I came out with a series of questions and things that I was wrestling with, because it's very different. Like, no one, I want to remind everybody, at that time, no one was talking about Breonna Taylor. No one.
Yes.
And so that was one of my questions, was like, hey, not that I don't care, but hello. Like, and then George Floyd called out for his mother. So again, what's the role of black women? So I say all this to say, when we make a decision about when to speak out and what to say, I think it's tricky. And sometimes I don't have a statement to make. And so then I'm trying to teach the students, to bring it all the way around, I'm trying to teach our students, you don't always have to make a statement. But if you can learn to ask questions, and you don't have to do it in the moment, because was I beat up? Yeah, for like 3 days. But if I don't have anything to add, then I'm not going to speak out at that moment, or I'm not going to ask my questions at that moment. And so that's where I'm trying to figure out what that balance is when do you sit back, and how do you teach people to sit back, listen, think, and it's okay to ask a bunch of questions. So we've done the same thing on abortion. I was like, it's a hot topic. Well, what are our questions? What are we wrestling with? Not, I have a statement about it, but what are we wrestling with?
I'm just going to go home and type into my AI chat bot. please write a statement from a college president, you know, responding to students after a tragedy, and we'll see if I get a poem. You know, right?
I think you have to send the prompt for a poem.
Yeah, yeah.
Please write a poem about.
But again, you know, that level of judgment and personal reaction, right? Please, Bryon.
I think at the heart of everything we do is about adulting. The wonderful thing about residential college is that when your student leaves from your house, They are coming from a school district that is supposed to put forth a certain set of values. And those values are going to be different when they get to college, and they're going to conflict. And our job is, you know, the greatest gift any of us can give any human being is the ability to self-create, to sit and say, no, my ideas may be wrong, or I can see your point. I still don't agree with that point, but now I can see where you're coming from. That's our job. And only does that happen in colleges and environments where students are alone, they're away from their parents. I get tired of the idea that we're brainwashing students. We're not doing a good job at it. The number one brainwasher is their parents. The children return to the politics of their parents overwhelmingly. Where I do think we can do better is, and I've said this to the faculty many times, we need to bring in people that make you uncomfortable, and you need to model how that action happens about you disagreeing with someone in a respectful, intellectual way where you could still go out and have a beer afterwards. And so we could show our students how that's done. And that's our challenge. It's easy to bring in someone you agree with and just agree with them. It's way more difficult to bring in someone you disagree with and show the proper way to do that.
And we all have a lot of technology in our pockets, and where is the app that's helping us do that, right? We do have a moment or two for a quick question if somebody has something. Yes, go ahead. Sure. And, you know, I think we're talking about a lot of different soft skills, right? We were just talking about being a democratic citizen as a soft skill. So I think you heard some answers already about that. Are there other, called soft skills that you think technology can help with?
We've done NACE badging, and we've won 2 years. We won awards for the NACE badging. So the student demonstrates either digitally or analog in real life, leadership, critical thinking. And then they get a badge from NACE that says that they do this. We use a digital platform for tracking and keeping track of them, and then they take them out with their transcripts to their employers, and they have seven badges of soft skills.
Yeah, great.
Could I have one thing? So, no, I haven't seen anything that works. Like, ugh. Because it's hard. It's actually really hard to measure. And what I've said is, back to my video game, my love of video games, what I really think is that if there are a way for us to observe students playing video games, I would actually learn everything I needed to know about cooperation, about like risk-taking, about decision-making. Cheating. Did you say cheating? We like to call it cheat. It's cheat codes, and it's fine. But where I'm going with that is, I think that instead of the answer being always a build solution, right, like let me build a product so that we can test and badge. No, there's stuff that students are already doing. If they're already doing that already in a virtual environment, I think the question becomes, and any of you can pay me for this idea, is that then we actually need the software that says, okay, but help me analyze that. That's why I was so fascinated by that Korean company, because what they were doing was they're watching you do something and they're sending you back the information with the analysis. So no, I think it's hard to build, but I think you can meet, like go look at their comments back on Instagram. Like, did you comment back in a civil way, or were you just like, oh my God, I can't believe you wore that? Right. Anyway, that's a real comment.
Yeah. Yeah, and then how do you, right, no, but I think that's a perfect example, right? Where do we see these things? And it's very context dependent. The way people respond on Twitter is not, you know, you call the person right up and you say, I saw your comment to me, and they say, oh, I didn't think you'd read it, and I didn't. Yeah, you had a question.
Yes, Marjorie, thanks, great panel. Making a comment about something, and you're 3 days, and I can relate to that on a number of deal with by not making a statement, you're making a statement.
Jeff, you want to take that one, and then we'll try to get one more question in. So be brief.
Yeah, I'll be brief. This is, I think, not rocket science because we stole it from somewhere else. But for us, I'm not going to make a statement on everything. We point to the value statement on our site often, and that suffices. Obviously, if it impacts Alma College, Alma students, our local community, I do then comment. But otherwise, we have that statement for folks to point to.
Yeah, that's great. We had a question right there. Yeah.
And so I'm kind of curious for each of you and your visions, in higher ed, what needs to be built that isn't there yet, and what needs to be destroyed that is still there?
That is such a good question. Oh. You might have 4 job offers on college campuses by the time you walk out of here. So that was awesome. And a perfect way to end, we only have a few seconds. So what are you building and what are you destroying?
Well, I think one of the things that we see with higher ed is it absorbs well. I mean, who would have ever thought that the University of Phoenix would be being bought by a nonprofit? So we see disruptors come in, and we take over them eventually. Badging, certificates, adult education, all these things. So one of the things that I know we appear to be slow moving, but we're intentionally moving and in absorbing different activities. So I think we're becoming more egalitarian as we move along. And if you think women were brought into education, minorities were brought into education, international students are brought into education, it's more and more embracing as we go through.
Good. What are you building? What are you destroying?
I destroyed a lot. On my way into Bennett, destroyed the traditional 16-week semester. So just it's all the structures. To me, we should question all the structures. And so sometimes I say I'm running a 150-year-old startup. And so what can we do? So to me, nothing's off limits. We should blow it all up. And I could go on and on. But then what was it? What am I building? I think trying to build a place where in the HBCU space in particular, that people think of us for testing ideas, that people think of us as the place, and I know Mr. Richardson is somewhere, Eddie Richardson, there he is, he's heard me say this before, that, I think that Bennett has the opportunity to be a place like an MIT Media Lab, where people think, oh, if I'm interested in the intersections of race and gender, this is the place to go to test ideas. So that's what I'm trying to build right now is that open, being open to and for the future and being a place that people say, oh yeah, okay, I wanna come and play over there and try something out.
Perhaps for the sector building, very briefly, I think what we're building together is a deeper integration with business, with the corporate world. We are emphasizing skills and competencies, but that is not all. And I think too often here we've heard, that's it. That's all we got to focus on. That is not it. That's a portion of it. We need to sustain the core of what we do at the same time. I hope we can, if not destroy, then move away from, is the credit hour basis on which we function for 120 years. I think that limits us in so very many ways. But I don't much like the model that's being advocated for here, wherein it all just becomes online and you get those in any way willy-nilly. We can do this work on our own campuses and build different approaches that will deepen learning for all of our students.
We're cutting it off. So come up here and ask your questions. Listen to this very smart woman there. They haven't shut my microphone off.
Oh, you do love your...
Yes, absolutely. Right, we absolutely. So thank you all so much for coming. We really appreciate it.